the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. This is a joint public hearing, and we do have four.
Mayor, it's not a joint public hearing, as a misprint. It says.
It is a public hearing. I was looking for the planning commission. Public hearing, and we do have four proposals this evening. The first is an ordinance amendment to Chapter 30, zoning of Christiansburg Town Code in regards to provisions for private recreational facilities in the Industrial One Limited Industrial District with a conditional use permit. Is there anyone here that would like to speak to this request? Yes, sir. If you'll stand, state your name, please.
My name is David Hardy. Do I need to go to the podium?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
If you can speak loud.
I just wanted to talk a little bit about the organization that we're wanting to use the permit, the facility for. That's a baseball, softball, boys and girls, 14 years of age and younger. I want to use the old Reed building for year-round practice. It's a non-profit organization made up of coaches and volunteer parents. We have six teams, four baseball and two softball teams. We make up about 50 families from all over the New River Valley. Our practice is going to consist of 9 to 14 players and two or three coaches at any one given time. During the week, Sundays through Thursday, it'll be 5 to 9. Friday, we're looking to change the hours a little bit on the original. I would like to amend that. It would be from 9 a.m. to possibly 11 p.m. on the weekends, Friday and Saturday. The only reason we're looking at that is because we could run practice a little bit longer due to kids not having to go to school the next day. Fundraising and stuff that we do some cornhole tournaments, golf tournaments, raffles, concessions, business donations, and smaller team fundraisers. As far as the facility use, we'd like to use the rebuilding mostly October through March due to practices being outside April through September. Maximum of 30 people in the building at one time. Just because of the size, we just can't get more than two teams inside at one time. We have two batting cages, two pitching mounds. And then as far as the cornholes, we do use that for fundraising. Players and parents use the entrance of Sullivan Street for depot to keep from driving through the residential area. Parking being directly in front of the building. Overflow would be across the road, even though we really don't intend to use that much, if any, to use the overflow. And I'd just like to thank you for considering this permit.
Okay. Anyone else wish to speak to this request?
Would you like for me to read the Planning Commission's recommendation?
It wouldn't hurt for us to hear that at this point.
Whereas the Christiansburg Planning Commission is found following a duly advertised public hearing on January 9, 2012, that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit the town council to adopt an ordinance amending the Christiansburg Town Code. Therefore, be it resolved, Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends to the Christiansburg Town Council that Section 30-106M of Chapter 30, zoning of Christiansburg Town Code, be amended as follows. And Section 30-106, permitted uses generally. This is under Limited Industrial District, I-1. In the I-1 Limited Industrial District, structures to be erected or land to be used shall be for one or more of the following uses. And item M is public buildings to consist of fire, police, and rescue squad stations and recreation facilities. Private buildings to consist of non-profit recreation facilities with a conditional use permit. Dated this 23rd day of July, 2012.
Mr. Helms, what was that last portion?
Part M, public buildings to consist of fire, police, and rescue squad stations and recreational facilities. Private buildings to consist of non-profit recreational facilities with conditional use permit.
Thank you, sir.
Did they intentionally make that nonprofit?
Yes, I think.
Okay, we'll discuss that later. Mr. Hardy, in addition to baseball instruction that'll take place there, will you offer private lessons to young people who may want to learn to hit better?
That's something that we've really not discussed. We do have a board and organization that'd be something we would bring in front of the board.
Sort of like the academy that they have, I believe it's in North Carolina, where students can come and pay a fee to learn. Okay, all right, thank you.
Mr. Mapple, one question for Mr. Hardy as well, if I could.
Yeah.
I know Zach was talking about and had a chance to go by, and you all have actually done quite a bit of improvements inside of the building.
Yes, sir.
I mean, other than the columns, you're set up perfectly for what you're looking for.
Yes, sir.
Is it the way, is it, I take it there is a, you have your board, and then you have individual organizations that are part of that, that have the permission to go in? Is that the way it works, or how is it set up?
No, sir, we have the organization, and we have teams set up. We have 11U, 12U, 213U baseball teams, and then we have a 10U and a 14U softball team.
And what's the moniker that you all fall under? What's the team, the organization name again?
The NRB Hurricanes.
NRB Hurricanes.
Yes. All right.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else wish to speak to this request?
And it's only going to be softball and baseball at this time?
Yes, sir.
And the ages was, again, that you're basically working with?
It's all kids 14 years of age and less. Right.
Okay. There's no one else to speak to this request. We'll close that part of the public hearing. And number two is contingent on item one, which is a conditional use permit by David Harding, agent for the owner, Connie Reed, for a private recreational facility at 195 Sullivan Street, tax parcels 526-371 in the I-1 Limited Industrial District. Anyone wish to speak to this conditional use permit request?
Would you like for me to read
it? Yes, go ahead and read that, if you will, Mr.
Planning Jones. Commission's recommendation. Whereas the Christiansburg Planning Commission, acting upon a request by Christiansburg Town Council to study a request made by David Harding, agent for property owner Connie Reed, for a private recreation facility at 195 Sullivan Street, tax parcel 526-3-71 in the I-1 Limited Industrial District, has found following a duly advertised joint public hearing with council that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit the issuance of a conditional use permit to David Harding for a non-profit recreation facility at 195 Sullivan Street in the I-1 Limited Industrial District. Therefore, be it resolved that the Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends that Christiansburg Town Council approve the conditional use permit with the following conditions. This permit is valid for baseball and softball programs and cornhole beanbag toss activities only. Hours of operations shall be limited between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. There shall be no excessive noise between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. This permit is subject to inspections and approval of facilities and equipment by the fire marshal, building official, and rescue squad captain. The town of Christiansburg requires that applicants use and maintain the facilities and equipment in accordance with equipment manufacturer's guidelines. This permit shall be valid for the applicants only and is non-transferable. Parking for the operation shall be limited to the existing parking area immediately in front of the building on the property or on the parking vacant area immediately in front of the building located on tax parcel 526-3-72 across the street. This permit shall be subject to review by the Planning Commission 1 year. The applicant shall provide no through traffic signage at no cost to the town if deemed appropriate by Town Street Committee. And this was dated 23rd day of July 2012, and 8 ayes and no nays. What did I say? January.
Did I understand you to say that the conditional use permit would be for 1 year, subject to review and renewal?
It said it'd be subject to review by the Planning Commission 1 year. It's not 1 year conditional use permit, be reviewed in 1 year.
All right, is there anyone else who would like to speak to this conditional use permit request?
Did I hear that they would like to amend the hours from 9 a.m. to 11 p.m.?
Just for Friday, Saturday.
Okay.
Okay, anyone else? If not, then we will close this public hearing. And the next is a proposed ordinance amendment to Chapter 30, Zoning of Christiansburg Town Code in regards to multifamily density allowances in the B3 General Business District. Is anyone here that would like to speak to this request? Yes, sir.
Good evening. I'm Steve Simonis with Balzer & Associates, 448 Peppers Ferry Road. The next two, this one and then the one following, are part of kind of the same application. We're representing the property owner, RWW36, as well as the contract purchaser of the 21 acres that comes up with the CUP request, item number four, I believe, on the agenda, Mega Builders. Frank Ford with Mega Builders is here tonight as well to answer any questions council may have. The first request that we have tonight with the code change, as I said, it kind of dovetails into our CUP request, and I'll kind of touch on it a little bit, but hold most of the presentation, I guess, for our next for the next public hearing. But what we're asking for right now for the code change is in the B3 district, which is property is zoned right now, multifamily use is a use that's allowed with a conditional use permit within the zoning district. What we've asked and proposed for a code change is to allow a higher density than what's currently allowed, which is 10 units per acre. And what we have drafted right now is 20 units per acre within B3. The project we're working at is much less than that. It's around 13.9, 14 units per acre. But right now, the way the language for the code amendment is drafted is at 20. So again, a lot of this ties into our next the next public hearing. But if there's anything specifically on the code change that I could answer, I'd be happy to. If anybody has any questions.
Okay, thank you. Any questions, Council?
Is there any reason that you're asking, Steve, for 20 units per acre? Because if you're working on the concept plan of 13, would you not ask for 15?
We started off with about 330 units, and since the first submittal, we're down to 295. So we were around that 15 mark, and as we talked to staff, we wanted to look a little bit ahead and not necessarily say if we're at 15, we're going to ask for 16 just so we squeeze under it. So 20, if you look at the central business district downtown, I believe townhouses are allowed at a higher density. Is it 20 units, I believe?
20 for townhouses and 30 for apartments.
So it seemed in a B3 district that's kind of your highest business use, that 20 was the next logical step up. Obviously, if council and thinks otherwise, we're around that 13 or 14, like I said, unit per acre, I guess right at 14. But that's the reason, Mr. Barber, we started at 20. It seemed like the next natural step in that process.
Okay. Any other questions?
The Planning Commission had a tie vote on this recommendation. It's 4-4, so they do not have a recommendation at this point.
Okay. Is there anyone else that wants to speak to this request? Yes, sir.
My name is Samuel Bauer. I reside at 100 Allegheny Street. I have some concerns about this amendment, not particularly in reference to the project that was just spoken to, but to the generality of raising the density in all B3, which is quite a bit of the space available in this town. I understand that many people believe that the CUP being required for this sort of thing adds a level of protection, which indeed it does, because each large project at least would be reviewed. However, I am concerned that the CUP itself is a very expensive proposition to monitor, and I don't believe that the CUPs that exist at this time, a long list of them which is readily available, have been properly monitored, and I understand that we cannot monitor them simply as a matter of financial responsibility. It's too expensive. So I think that the ramifications of allowing this in all of B3 could be something that could come and bite us later on if this leads to more of this kind of construction. Again, I say I'm not necessarily concerned about the immediate project for which this is being done in that light. So I simply want to make that point that if you do pass this modification of the ordinance, then it will have ramifications on many more acres of property in the town, and that could be a negative proposition down the line. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bauer. Anyone else wish to speak to this request? Ms. Carroll?
Yeah, my name is Carol Lindstrom. I live at 630 Depot Street. That's okay. I knew who I was. I pretty much have the same sentiments that Mr. Bauer did, in that this is, you know, this is really a beautiful project. It's in a good location. As a business owner, I can see this having a beneficial impact on businesses. However, once you start looking at making a zoning like that change that is going to be townwide, every place another one of these parcels is zoned, you stand the potential for a CUP to be in place. And when you have a CUP come up, it becomes up to council to determine whether something is appropriate or not. And that's something that's changeable. Your codes are not as easily changed. I would just ask the town to think seriously about whether to change something townwide, or maybe there could be some other way to come up with something that would allow a zoning application in this specific site and go ahead with a great looking project, but not jeopardize the other business areas of town. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else to speak to this request? If not, then we'll close that portion of the public hearing and we'll continue this discussion, because contingent on item 3, the conditional use permit request by Bowser & Associates, agent for property owner RWW 36 LLC, for a planned housing development at the end of Farmview Road Northeast, tax parcel 436A, 37, 38, 39, 40, and 41, and a portion of 436-A-35 and 36. In the B3 General Business District. So anyone that would like to speak to this conditional use request? Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am, go ahead. I'm sorry, I didn't see your hand. If you can stand right there, speak loudly.
Oh, yes, I do that. My name is Krista Hinkelmann. I live in Blacksburg. I have been here 46 years, so I'm not a newcomer. People might not know me since I live over there, but I own a house in Wheatland, so that's why I'm interested what's going on. I'm not speaking for Wheatland. I'm only voicing my own opinion. I have walked around the property, been to all meetings, have seen the plans, and I have come to the conclusion that this project will be a good addition to the neighborhood if things are done as promised. Otherwise, we might end up with Costco or Sam's Club with noise and big trucks day and night. And this is a retirement community where people want peace and quiet. The problem with the second exit at Kmart should be addressed soon by the Planning Commission, Traffic Commission, or VDOT, or whoever else is responsible for this. And maybe the construction traffic and later 1,200 car trips per day from this unit could be divided in two roads. The one coming out at Kmart, on the other one at Farmview, where the retirement community is. And also, I think it would be a good idea for police, fire department, and emergency vehicles would be better off with two exits. I hope a wise decision can be made that everybody can live with this. I was a developer. Good luck with this project.
All right, thank you, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Steve?
Again, Steve Simonis with Balzer and Associates. Included with our package was a big packet of material. I'm going to hit the highlights. I'm sure everybody's had a chance to look through it. We've discussed it in length at Planning Commission. But if council would permit, I want to hit, as I said, a couple of highlights as we go through the package of information. And then how we made some changes from the first Planning Commission meeting to the second. And then a couple others we've made just over the last week or so. This property, if you can see on the aerials or any of the maps we've provided, is about 21 acres of the big piece of property back behind Kmart, Lowe's, and Grand. RWW36 owns this property. Mega Builders out of Greensboro are looking to develop this 21 acres as a multifamily project. Megan, I'm not sure, do you guys have copies of these? They're here if you want to pass them around. These are some examples of some of the projects that Mega has worked on in the past. They're a Class A multifamily builder. This will be their first foray into Virginia, and they really like this location, like Christiansburg. So we started working with them back in December and looking at the project and the property. When we looked at this property, we saw the B3, knew we had to do a conditional use permit, and spent a lot of time looking back at the comprehensive plan, the future land use map, as far as what was appropriate in this area. In 2006, 2007, this property had originally been in Montgomery County. It went through a boundary line adjustment. At that time, it was proposed, I believe, with the concept plans and the traffic studies that were done, to be 100% commercial. There was a lot of big box retails in there, restaurants, gas stations, strip mall type of development, produced a lot of traffic. As we looked at this and saw that the conditional use permit was an option, we came down and met with staff, with Randy and the rest of the staff, and looked at how we might be able to make this work. The biggest question that's come up, as Mr. Helms said, was the code change and how's the best way to make this project fit with the land, with the zoning, and with our neighbors. We talked about a couple different options, whether it's a straight rezoning, whether we do the B3 and ask for the additional density. The 10 units per acre that the town allows right now, I believe, is town-wide in any of the zoning districts. The 10 units per acre is kind of the max we can hit with a multifamily development. Regionally, that's a fairly low density. So when we looked at trying to add some in, we looked at the options, and one of the options, I guess, was looking at a rezoning on the property, you know, complete rezoning on this 21 acres. And one of the things we saw, it was still going to require a code change in order to get a higher density, because it all refers back to your multifamily zoning district, which allows, again, by right up to 10 units per acre. So this looked like, through our conversations with staff and as we looked through it and talked with, you know, my client and the owners, this looked like the best way to kind of make the project work. It still allows, as the gentleman back here stated a few minutes ago, still gives town council and planning commission the ability to review all multifamily requests, whether the density is set at 20 acre or 20 per acre or 15 per acre, or it stays at 10, it's still a conditional use permit. And, you know, based on where the property is located in a future rezoning or a CUP request, can dictate what those unit densities are. But as we looked at it, this area right here, it's got the infrastructure from a transportation and utility standpoint that a project like this could really fit in well. As I said, it's a Class A apartment complex, which we really don't have in Christiansburg. If you go back through the comp plan, a lot of the apartment complexes we do have in town are lower income, subsidized, Section 8. There are some newer ones over on Radford Road that have been very successful from my understanding. So this will be a product and that we really don't have in Christiansburg. We've got shown on here a clubhouse, an outdoor pool, a pool house, a standalone gym, tennis courts, a lot of amenities for the property owners or for the residents of the apartments. As we look through, and again, I'm already dragging on, not really hitting high points here. We looked through the utilities, water and sewer capacity. One of the questions the Planning Commission had was to ask the town engineering department to take a look at what our projected flows were based on our resident count. Mr. Nelson has provided a letter, I believe, to staff and to the Planning Commission on that. The project itself is planned to be phased. Right now, we're at 295 units in 10 buildings. Phasing-wise, Mega is planning to build probably the first five buildings and the amenity packages up front, see how the leasing rates go, see how all that turns out, and then kind of roll into phase two. So hopefully it will be a continuous roll of construction, so it's not going to be phase one and we stop for a year, is the way we'd like it to go. Stormwater management, stormwater quality, we've looked at currently. The divide between the Roanoke River and the New River is right across the top of this property. If you look up there behind Grand, the property breaks right there. So everything on the property we're looking at drains back to the bypass out into the county and hits the Roanoke River watershed. So we've got two preliminary areas shown for stormwater management that would catch our stormwater for quantity and quality requirements. Mega intends to hire a full-time property management company that would run the facility and hire, of course, some local folks to take care of the grounds and the landscaping. One of the things that we looked at from the beginning, and I'm glad our neighbor of Wheatland is here tonight, was how we could mitigate some of the concerns, and we knew that would be traffic and noise. So one of the things we started at when we first started the project was we've got some additional buffering, some landscape buffering shown up against the back property line. There's a board-on-board fence as you run down Farmview up to this property, and it varies between 6 and 8 feet. There's a chain link fence on the back here that we've talked about and agreed that we would, if Wheatland wants us to, we'll go back in and replace that chain link fence for a board-on-board that would match what's going up the road right now to, again, give some additional screening. We met with Wheatland after our first Planning Commission meeting to see some of the issues that came up. We set up a meeting, and Rob Barrett with Commonwealth, who's the owner-operators of Wheatland, offered us a place over there at Wheatland to come in and meet with the residents out there. We delivered letters and asking all the residents to come to the meeting and inform them as far as what the project was and answer questions for, I don't know, an hour and a half or so. And I think the biggest thing, and I don't want to speak for Wheatland, but the biggest thing that we saw was just making sure traffic was taken care of, and it was going to be a nice project, that it wasn't going to be a big conflict between uses. This isn't set up to be an undergraduate student housing complex. I think from the rental rates they're looking at, the location of it, the amenity packages, and then the qualifications that Mega goes through for their tenants, the idea would be young professional, grad student, osteopathic school, you know, students, that type of clientele. As we went back after the first Planning Commission meeting, there were a couple things that we wanted to go back and take a look at again. Traffic was obviously, again, one of the biggest concerns. What we had done is there was a traffic study done in 06 and 07 by Mattern and Craig out of Roanoke for the original rezoning request. We took some of that base information and modeled our new traffic from our proposal into that to take a look at what the impacts just on the Farmview intersection would be. Planning Commission asked us if we could update that a little bit more, so we got some traffic counts from 09 from VDOT that they were doing when they were in the process of working through the 114 road improvements. So we used that information, updated it, and from our preliminary traffic analysis, and Chris Burns here from our office in Roanoke, because our traffic engineer is here tonight too if there are any specific questions on it. But as we looked through it, it didn't appear from our initial look-see that we were going to be having any major impacts that would require any improvements to the Farmview intersection. We looked at how far back the traffic would stack and the AM and the PM peaks, and what we did is we modeled it basically with all 295 units coming out to that stop sign, to that stoplight right there. Again, as we move through the Planning Commission, one of the things that's been requested and we've agreed to is, I believe the way it's worded right now, is one of the conditions that before the 200th unit receives the certificate of occupancy, that the secondary entrance would go in, which would be right here on the north end of the project, come back through the rest of the RWW property that would be remaining for commercial use and tie into the back of the Kmart piece. One of the concerns was everybody that might be going towards Blacksburg in the mornings backing traffic up at that light at Pondview, and if they're all trying to get out to the bypass, how can we get them to 114 a little bit easier? We looked at some areas back behind Grand and Lowe's, and if you've been out there, obviously you can see the bank. There's the main transmission gas line that comes, I don't know where it starts, somewhere in Tennessee, I think, makes its way through, kind of comes right through this area, and it's about 3 or 4 feet deep. So from a grading standpoint, in order to grade down to get a road to physically tie in from point A to point B, would require lowering the gas line. And when we've looked at this in the past for some other folks, lowering this gas line in this area could run about $700,000 to $800,000. So from a project standpoint, we're trying to look at another option, obviously. The same owner that owns RWW36 has an interest in Kmart as well. And I believe with the original rezoning, this is the location where a third access was shown to basically come through, use it as a cross access through Kmart, and that would get you right out to Laurel, and then you can make your way to 114, heading out to the bypass. So that was one of the big things from a planning commission standpoint that we tried to look at to help mitigate some of the traffic concerns. Again, that's set up right now at the 200th CO. That road would have to be in, and I believe Mr. Huppert brought it up earlier that there was a time limit involved with that, and I'm not sure if it states that in the current conditions, but I know that was discussed.
4 or 5 years.
Mr. Simonis, is the only impediment to the secondary access route being created earlier, is it mainly the cost that's going to be associated with that second road?
There's going to be cost with it. You know, you've got probably about 700 feet of road through that area that would have to go in. I mean, the thought would be, all the initial dirt work, the big heavy mass grading, is going to be done with phase one. So the thought would be all the units, they're not built yet, but all the units, all the pads, all the parking lots, stormwater, all that is graded out and done in phase one. So as traffic starts to come up, as you start leasing the units and more people are using Farmview, that's when we could put the secondary access in, work something out with Kmart and the property owner as far as maybe moving some construction traffic through on that side as well. The idea is once the big dirt moving equipment's off, you know, well, Frank, I'll maybe let you speak to this a little bit, that we wouldn't have as much traffic, construction traffic, heavy construction traffic daily, you know, going up and down Farmview.
So is the only impediment then the price, or is there a preclusion because has it been worked out, or there have been future negotiations with that?
The biggest thing on this one is what we haven't wanted to do. And it's kind of a chicken and the egg. We want to be sure as best we can that we can determine the best location for that road, because that's going to be a key point in how that future property develops. From the very beginning, when this was originally, again, with the original master plan and rezoned, there were three access points: Farmview, there was a right in, right out on Franklin, kind of in the middle of the property, and then this access back through Kmart. So our hope would be that a commercial developer would come in over the next 5 years and, you know, be working through a development plan that we could work in and tie in together. We don't want to do anything that's going to negatively impact the ability to develop the other piece of property. And there's only so many places we can put it. We don't want to get over into the gas line again, and it's going to go in this general direction. So we'd like to get the project started, get moving on the project, start getting the thing going before we have to get into that cost and tie down that location,
and again,
100%.
And I'm trying to, you know, beating this dead horse, but the issue, though, right now, as far as that second access, in addition to what you said, the main issue is cost associated with that second access point.
I really don't know if that's the main. Okay. Yeah,
but
I don't think that's the main.
As far as putting that second route in there, are there any other impediments as of now having a second route earlier than the 5 years?
No, not a physical impediment to it. The gas line, we're going to be adjusting the gas line. We've already talked to the property owner. He's willing to work with us. We're not planning to put a full public 50-foot right-of-way down through there. What it would be is a ingress-egress cross-access agreement that would allow anybody to use it, but it wouldn't be set up as a town road.
And so affirmatively, the property owners they agreed that
right.
No issue about coming through there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that doesn't require any future, not so much negotiations, but just kind of fine points being determined?
Fine points, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
There were a couple other things as far as the traffic analysis that was, or the traffic studies that we were asked to look at. Check with some of the localities around as far as what they use for trip generation for multifamily projects. We also are trying to create some pedestrian access in here as well. When Farmview's obviously, if you've driven up there, Farmview's going to have to be approved to town standards. One of the items on that would be extending the sidewalk from our property down to the intersection of Farmview to tie into the sidewalk infrastructure down there, as well as the secondary access that goes out to Kmart would have a sidewalk or a walking trail that would help get some other people into the shopping area right in there. We've come back in with a cul-de-sac at the end of Farmview, which we didn't have originally. We proposed a bus stop for BT or any school bus. School children would be there right here at the end of Farmview before you hit the project. And since our last meeting, last Planning Commission meeting last week, I guess the only other concern with our Wheatland neighbors is we do have some parking spaces right along this property line. We're about 20 feet, I guess, about 20 feet off the property line. And it's probably another 75 feet or so to the first unit on Wheatland. But what we've made, we've got an agreement with Wheatland and Commonwealth that if the plan moves forward, if council sees fit to approve it, we move forward with construction documents, that if we find other places to relocate some of that parking, that'll be the first parking that either gets removed or relocated. And we've already, I guess as of last week, we had about 12 spaces in there. So just over the last week, we found a place where we can move about 5 of those. So we've cut it down to 7. So there's a grade change between those properties as well. The parking lot's going to sit about 4 feet below the property line. So again, we're trying to do things that's going to minimize any, traffic, car lights shining into the Wheatland, try to minimize the noise. So again, with that, the vegetation, the fencing that we're putting in, hopefully we've mitigated as much as we can with Wheatland.
Steve, I might have an old copy of the guidelines that we have posted here, but as I recall, we talked a great deal about at the end of Farmview having a dual exit right there, so you could turn, there would be a right and left lane in that road. And I thought, was that one of the restrictions that that the Planning Commission put in? I don't see it here online.
There were two things that were brought up there at the end. One was that upon approval of town engineering and the street committee, that we would look at possibly doing a kind of a two-way stop. It's not showing right here. I guess it's right there at the same
time. Is that the red light near Sheets? And so they could just turn right and they just stop there and they don't have to wait on the left?
That's one of them. Yeah, the first one was setting up a stop situation where people coming out of this development would stop here at Sunset for people coming out of Wheatland and the daycare. So maybe setting up a two-way stop there if it's something that would work with the engineering staff and the street committee to again set up a stop creation there, situation where you don't have people coming down that hill and somebody pull out of Sunset. So that's one of the things. The other one was taking a look at this intersection and whether a right turn lane coming off of Farmview, hanging a right going north on North Franklin, is appropriate, warranted, needed. But again, that would be with town staff and street committee, I believe, is how it's worded.
What about the condition on the Planning Commission recommendation?
So as Farmview is now, when you're coming back out to Franklin,
mm-hmm.
you're saying it's only two lanes. It's the incoming lane, and it's the lane coming out of there?
Yes, sir. It's tight. There was questions the other night of whether you could squeeze two cars in there. It'd be tight. You'd have to be right on the yellow line to let somebody get around. Now, again, the preliminary stuff we've looked at during those peak hours in the a.m. and the p.m., we're showing everything's still functioning okay at Farmview with the traffic coming out on it. And again, that was not taking into account the secondary road. We were trying to put all the traffic on there and show kind of a worst case scenario. But again, those are the preliminary numbers we've worked in with the trip generation from our development and the old VDOT numbers.
What can you all do, and I put the emphasis on you all do, as far as obtaining the lane to the right of way to widen the area right there at the stoplight?
Mm-hmm.
I think if you try to operate this thing with one lane coming out and then go left, right, or straight through, I think it's a point, Grant. I think that you're going to have more problems than you anticipate.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would prefer to see is that there be some way that you all, whether it be purchasing a right-of-way or land or whatever, come up with enough to widen that street to meet your needs, which would be two lanes coming out, one lane going in, and
mm-hmm.
one of the lanes would be a right turn, the other would be a combination left turn straight through.
Right.
That's my comfort level with it. In addition to having another entrance available when the construction starts, because I really don't want to see the construction traffic going up and down Farmview.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather
we talked about that with construction traffic, especially up front. And, you know, our thought was you've got a limited amount of traffic on Farmview right now. You know, you do have Wheatland, you've got the daycare up there, a few of the offices, and I guess the car wash there as well. Heavy equipment trying to maneuver through the Kmart parking lot caused us a little bit more heartburn up front. And that was the question, that if you go through get the first part of the heavy stuff done first, and you're talking about less, you know, more framers coming in with their trucks and plumbers and that stuff, and not the heavy earth moving, you know, stuff up and down the roads, that Farmview's, as it's unimproved right now past the intersection, would be a better way to take it until some of the mass grading stuff. But we're open to it.
Steve, it appears that the flow of traffic from Farmview and Wheatland would be directed toward the mall or toward, what did we used to call it, 3A, which was the 460, which is access to the bypass.
Mm-hmm.
Coming out of Farmview and being able to make a left turn
mm-hmm.
on Franklin Street, Mike says that could be a bottleneck there if you're not. It depends on the traffic coming out.
Right.
But I would rather see traffic directed more toward Blacksburg and mm-hmm. the bypass, so folks would have access to the bypass whether they want to go east or west.
Right.
I think what the good mayor's trying to say, or I'm reading it this way, when it comes to a case of heartburn, I'd rather it be yours than mine.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to see some road solutions, possibilities before we go any further on this one.
And Mr. Simonis, in reading the plan, it's a fantastic plan that was submitted. The reality is, you are looking at this is going to be done fairly quickly. I think it's even mm-hmm. estimated that the possibility of this entire development is completed within 24 months. Is that correct?
Yes,
I have a statement, I believe, in here, and I can't remember the page, it was a large amount that we read. To echo, I believe what the mayor's saying and certainly Mr. Barber's saying, I'm on Farmview Road. I went up there. In fact, I got a chance to even go up there tonight again and went out and took a little left there. And coming back out, that's going to be an issue, frankly. I can see that just backing all the way up. And, of course, you've got the Allegheny Church coming into that. You've got people coming in. So, basically, you have this trifecta area coming to one outlet onto 460. The other question I have is, what is the reality of the – I know there's costs associated with it, but I think Mr. Barber put it well. That secondary outlet point, actually having that completed – and having two ingress points at that point, and not all that, and widening Farmview Road before the construction would begin.
I guess the secondary access out, I was just talking to Ms. Ford about it a little bit before the meeting. That's something we can look at. The intersection at Farmview, I guess my concern, speaking from my client's standpoint, is I've had some conversations with Mr. Stipes concerning our traffic. You know, traffic flows that we're projecting out and some of the other options we might have. I would hate from my client's standpoint and from my standpoint for us to go through and agree up front that we're going to do intersection improvements if they're not warranted. When the original traffic study was done, again, it was a large development. The whole thing was commercial. There was a Sam's, there was a gas and all that. There was quite a bit of intersection improvements proposed. So what we did when we went back and looked at it and started regenerating traffic was, you take that piece out of it. You know, there's going to be traffic improvements that have to be made when the commercial stuff comes in. What's going to be the impacts of our 295 units? And if there are impacts there that we're showing, we'll certainly, you know, it's upon us, and we'd have to do it in any other situation, in a by right situation, if we hit a threshold that we have to look at the traffic, if there are requirements, that we have to make improvements to keep an intersection from failing or backing traffic up in an unsafe way, that's something we have to do from an engineering standpoint as well as from a developer standpoint. But to just make the statement that we think it should be there and we're going to agree to put it there because we think it should be, I don't think it's the right way to go. I think if we need to do a little bit more analysis as we move through site plan, something to that effect, because again, some of the preliminary numbers aren't showing the need for it.
I guess what I was using is just the general rule of thumb that if you had, let's say 200 units, because that seems to be, when you go to your 200 occupants, certificate occupancy, they immediately have to build that secondary route. But at 200, and I'm thinking an apartment, I take it they're obviously multi-bedroom apartments, mm-hmm. let's say two cars at a minimum per apartment, that's 400, and the average usually between 6 to 8 trips per day. I'm just thinking, right now you've got Wheatland and Allegheny Church that come onto that access point to 460 mm-hmm. there, and you could have anywhere from, I think, very nominally, 1,200 trips a day that are going to hit that intersection that don't currently hit that intersection. Mm-hmm. That's at a low level.
Right.
Which could fluctuate spectrum-wise from 1,200 to say 2,000, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I really feel strongly about what Mr. Barber mentioned earlier as well, is that I understand about the doing the improvements, but mm-hmm. something had to be done going left to right there. You're going to have the traffic backed up, and only that, you're going to have Wheaton trying to come in, Delegan coming in. I see the potential for a problem. I understand there needs to be future study done,
right.
But some of it you don't have to study. The common sense would dictate that perhaps that needs to be done.
Well, and some of it, you know, we didn't come into it saying, you know, we're not going to have any problems. We did, you know, take the traffic that's been provided to us with the old study as well as updated VDOT counts, you know, along 460.
And the old study was the commercial, as if it was a commercial property, and that was all way inflated. I understand that.
Right, but we still took, you know, we took the base information, took the base, I guess, concepts as far as how the traffic was generated through there. We took the big box out of it, obviously. It's not going on this 21 acres and our 295R, and you know, fed that into our intersection model there. Then we updated it again with, you know, the 2009 additional 2009 counts that VDOT provided us. You know, I know traffic's the biggest concern. We understand that.
And safety.
Right. And it's one and the same, in my opinion. I mean, there's a inconvenience factor with traffic, but again, we want the intersection to be safe. We want it to function properly. We don't want to cause problems for, you know, Mr. Court's future residents or Wheatland or the car wash or anybody else.
And by the way, there was a presentation done to Wheatland, I understand. Mr. Ford. Mm-hmm.
So again, we're trying to show that we're hitting the high points as far as trying to, you know, mitigate the concerns with Wheatland. And I think traffic-wise, you know, again, we're going to eventually, and I can't say when, I can't say if it's in 2 years or 5 years or 10 years, when all the property develops, we will have the three access points that were approved with the original rezoning, including that right-in, right-out on Franklin Street. So, again, I think, you know, as this front commercial piece develops, there are going to be more improvements that are going to be required. We don't have a problem looking a little further into it, you know, as we move through plans to see, you know, if an intersection requirement's valid, if we have to do a second lane, if we have to retime some signals. I mean, that's, again, it's what I said, you know, from a standpoint that we have to do that on any project. You know, we've got to do our, so if it's required, we're okay with doing it, but we don't want to just agree to do it just because we think it might be necessary.
Mr. Simmons, Mike asked a question, I didn't hear the answer, but if you had to do something like that, widen that so that there's two mm-hmm. lanes coming out and one going in or so forth, is there land available to?
I don't know when you get right down, it's a 50 foot right of way as you go up Farmview. I'm not sure right there at the intersection how much those radiuses flare. I know right there there's storm sewer in place and concrete and, you know, for the sidewalks and things like that. I can't remember if there's a signal box or maybe a light pole or something right there on the intersection. I'm not sure if the right of way is out there to exist right now. If it's not, yeah, it would be, you know, getting easements or getting right of way from the church.
Or building a secondary point earlier than in the discussion.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And we haven't gone anything into the planning and operation of the units, but mm-hmm. How many parking places per unit are you allowing?
Town code requires two per unit, so that's what we have on there right now.
Is that a realistic figure, Steve?
I think so, with the unit count we're looking at. Frank, you want to?
My name's Frank Ford. I'm Director of Development for Mega Builders in Greensboro, North Carolina. We have a mix of one, two, and three-bedroom units. I don't know specifically enough about the Christiansburg two spaces per unit to identify this. I will say that, generally speaking, we currently operate 10 communities in three states, and we always have more parking, not less parking than we need. I realize that most people would say that on a two-bedroom unit, there's going to be two people occupying it, and they're both going to have cars, and so that, you know, you would normally think that you would need at least a minimum of two spaces per unit. But I think when you get 296 units and you build, and please don't make me do the math, 500 and some odd spaces, you end up with, usually we end up with about 10 to 15% of excess spaces that people just simply don't use. It's been our experience as apartment developers.
Been around a university environment much?
We currently operate 10 projects. Four of them are student projects. One at the University of West Virginia, one at the University of North Carolina at Wilmington, and so we and at Appalachian State University. So we are familiar with the constraints of the university. I will say that as Steve said, this is not primarily intended for, nor will we absolutely market it for students. But I think that students generally, and my understanding at Virginia Tech as well, is that there's really no sense to drive to campus because there's no place to park when you drive to campus. One of our real goals here is to, at both Appalachian State and at West Virginia, we provide transportation to and from the university to our students. Again, this isn't primarily a student property, but we would hope that we've talked to BT Transit, I believe it is, as well as two of the other local transit providers, and we certainly hope that not a majority, obviously, but a minority of our residents would utilize public transportation.
Steve, it's anticipated that all of these will be rental units?
Yes, sir.
Well, I think that the plans that I've seen and just the general concept is something that we do need here. I don't think that we're blessed with an abundance of upscale apartments in Christiansburg. And I think that I see the potential for these to do very well. My concern the whole time is not so much from the quality of the project that you're going to build, but it's the safety factor. Mm-hmm. And we have fought traffic on Franklin Street for the 12, 15 years that I've been on council and even before that. And I just think, you know, the possibilities of another 1,200 trips per day or more coming out of the one intersection onto another is just, I know that your studies say that it would work, but in practicality, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have seen that thing on Saturdays and game days and 8 o'clock in the morning and watched the flow of traffic coming from Christiansburg, or should I say Blacksburg Middle School, back to Christiansburg and taking the kids to school. And I know there's a heavy flow of traffic, and that's all right in your peak drive time. And, mm-hmm. that's my concern, is to be able to filter it out. God, I'd love it if you could some way cut an entrance on the bypass.
Right.
So they can go there. There's plenty of dead space over there. But that's my entire concern, is the fact that, and you know, I have a little concern about your construction times. I mean, you're building right in the back door of a retirement community. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure all these people are willing and ready to get up at 6 in the morning or whatever.
Well,
construction starts.
That was one of the questions when we met with Wheatland that they had as far as the construction and you know, erosion control, dust, noise, all that. You know, I know the town's got a very active erosion control engineering department now, keeping an eye on those things. And I'm not sure we haven't really talked about construction times, but, you know, I don't think we're starting at 5 in the morning and finishing up at 11.
No,
so,
we can assure you that. we'll assure you that you will not start then and finish that.
As I had said to the ladies and gentlemen who met with us at Wheatland, there's nothing that I can say that's going to be anything other than construction is loud, messy, and dirty. That's what it is. I think we do a good job of making it as less loud and as less dirty and as less messy as we can. As I said to the ladies and gentlemen at Wheatland, my deal is basically on cost. And to me, dirt is expensive. Ugly sites are expensive. And so I think we do a good job of doing things quickly, cleanly, and safely. Safely, I guess. Because it's not because it's good to our neighbors, but it is, but because it's economically good to us. And that's why we're quick, that's why we're safe, and that's why we're very clean. But, you know, there's nothing I can say to them, and there's nothing that I would say to you that's going to make you, to mitigate the fact that construction is loud and dirty.
Mr. Ford, the secondary access point then, that's been brought up a couple of times, and 200 plus, build it, 5 years, have to build it.
Right.
I guess the reality of the situation then would be that that could be changed to be done quite earlier. Would that be accurate?
You know, I think that our belief, and again, I think what Steve was trying to say and what I'm trying to say is that we go into these things and we hire professionals. They do the reports, and then if the traffic studies warrant the improvements, then we do them. And municipalities force us to do them based on them being warranted by professionals to tell us that they are. And so when we came into this initially, we were of the opinion, based on the information we got from professionals, that our development, because it actually was a down zoning, if you will, from what was allowed there by right today, and by what was done under the initial traffic study, that what we would do, that our development wouldn't create an unnecessary burden or a terrible burden on the Franklin Farmview intersection. We operate many, I think of the 10 that we currently own and operate, I think 8 of them have one entrance in and one entrance out. That's the way we prefer to do it. Obviously, Planning Commission had a real problem with that. I think the people at Wheatland wanted to see it done. And so I think based on our conversations with the seller, it was said that, you know, eventually they were going to do a entrance exit through the what I think is the Kmart Shopping Center. And so Steve asked us if we would be willing to kind of do that early, and we kind of said yes, and I think the seller kind of agreed to share with us that deal. But I think that entrance and exit is really more of what I would consider to be, it's not a full-blown street. So I don't want to take it to mean that I'm going to build a two-lane, you know, obviously it'll have stormwater considerations done to it, but to think of it as an access point for heavy construction materials and really, it's really just kind of a way to, I think, ease what you guys are obviously concerned about, Franklin Street, the Franklin Farmview intersection. So I don't want to, I think we would be disingenuous to think that we would construct this in a manner that we could almost never use Farmview, and this would be the sole right. entrance and exit to it. It's really kind of, from our perspective, something that we threw in to say, hey, you know, this would be really nice, and I think it'll help everybody out.
All right, let's pause right here. I think we're about ready to change tapes.
Whereas Christopher Planning Commission acting on a request by the Christopher Town Council to study a request by Balzer and Associates Incorporated, agent for property owner RWW36 LLC for planned housing development to end the Farmview Road, has found following a duly advertised joint public hearing with Council that the public necessity, convenience, general welfare, and good zoning practices permit the issuance of conditional use permit to Balzer and Associates Incorporated, agent for property owner RWW36 LLC for planned housing development at the end of Farmview Road in the B3 General Business District. Therefore, be it resolved, the Christiansburg Planning Commission recommends that the Christiansburg Town Council approve a conditional use permit with the following conditions, and there are 12. The present general conditions of the proposed mega building multifamily development as revised January 27, 2012 shall be considered as conditions of approval. The development shall be in general conformity with the presented Exhibit A site rendering and Mega Builders overall plan and Mega Builders conceptual master plan drawings as revised January 27, 2012. The development shall provide cul-de-sac at the end of Farmview Road. The development shall provide a bus shelter for future bus stop if deemed appropriate by the town. The development shall provide a second public ingress, egress, access, easement, or public street. Okay, let me start over with that one. The development shall provide a second public ingress, egress, access, easement, or public street, including trail or sidewalk directly connecting to Laurel Street, Wilson Street, Sycamore Street, or Pepper's Ferry Road prior to the issuance of certificate of occupancy for the 200th unit or 5 years from the issuance of the first building permit, whichever occurs first. Farmview Road Northeast shall be upgraded to North Franklin Street to the town engineer's satisfaction, including installation of sidewalks on one side of the street. The developer shall provide a trail connection to the remainder of either tax parcel 436A, 35, or 36 at a location to be approved by the town staff. Costs associated with water and sewer main upgrades will be borne by the developer. The development shall be limited to a maximum of 615 bedrooms. Stop signs shall be required at the intersection of Farmview Road and Sunset Drive if deemed appropriate by the town street committee and town engineer. A second lane shall be required at Farmview Road Northeast onto North Franklin Street if deemed appropriate by the town street committee and town engineer. There shall be a minimum of 3 feet green space between the curb line or sidewalk if the sidewalk is placed along the Whitland side or the southern side of Farmview Road. That was passed 8 A's and no no's.
Okay, is there anyone else that wishes to speak to the conditional use permit request? Mr. Bauer?
Much of my planned comment has been taken care of. Generally, I oppose large developments like this, but I must admit that these applicants have been responsible and responsive to other problems, and I think that they have a very solid plan. However, I would like to urge that council require the second entrance to be constructed with original construction, not at a later time. The reason for that is simple public safety. We have had difficulties in this area already with areas constructed without two ingress egress routes. And I think from a public safety point of view, for both fire, police, et cetera, it is really a necessity. And thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Bauer. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. We're Gary Glenn Hash. We're here to represent the interests of John and Nan Harrison. Property owners for 436-842, adjoining to the waste management area there on the property. I haven't heard anything said this evening. Because of health issues, they're not able to be here today. They are interested in, as their tax commercial, in the sale of the property in the future, and traffic becomes a major issue there that they're very informed to be rolling down. I'd like to hear that addressed. We need to get some peace on that. We're pro improvement, we're pro progress, we're pro John and Nan Harrison. So I want to know what you're looking at there. It was good you asked about the traffic study. That's imperative. It's a major thoroughfare in the accessibility of that property if it were to be sold on the market. A major selling, either go south or go north on it, the doability of it, with what happens there with Farmview. If there were, they have the premier piece of property, arguably so, on the top of that knoll.
Mr. Hash.
Yes, sir.
We are all so pro Nanny and John Harrison. And they live at 500 Sunset Drive.
They love Christiansburg.
Yes, and we love them. So thank you for your comments.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, ma'am, Ms. Lindstrom.
Carol Lindstrom again, 630 Depot Street. Haven't moved in the last 20 minutes. But my concerns, again, with this is primarily the traffic issue. The rezoning, of course, is a different issue. In this instance, I think it's a great project. I think it can do a lot of positive things for Christiansburg. I have some serious concerns whenever we have one point of access to an area, and that happens to be the one point of access to an area that is a large retirement community. but may need ambulance, may need fire trucks, may need your rescue personnel out there at any given moment, and a street that's busy enough that one accident out there could block access on that one access point. Even if it's not a paved road or something, we need something to verify that our ambulances and fire trucks can get through somebody's parking lot and cut across a field if they got to, but at least get to where people meet.
A good point, thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to address this request?
Can I make a comment, Mayor?
Yes, sir, you may.
I've remained silent on this, partly because I've lost my voice. I'm sounding much worse than I feel. I feel fine. But there's a very simple solution. I did attend the Planning Commission meeting. There's a very simple solution to the traffic question, which is in the front of my concerns as well. I support the development. I think it's a good plan, and said as much at the Planning Commission meeting. But we're not into discussion period, but I want to assure you that there is an easy solution to this traffic situation that has not been offered yet by the developer, but should the plan development move forward, I think it would serve the town well and the citizens well to have a traffic impact analysis is done according to VDOT standards. It's not been done yet. The plan that's been referenced was never approved by VDOT. But it's not too much to ask of the developer. I don't think it's certainly in the town's best interest to do that. VDOT has offered to review such a study, and whatever would come out of that study, whether it's zero or mega improvements, that would be part of the site plan. But that'll be part of our discussion, and my recommendation was not necessarily included in the Planning Commission recommendation.
But if that was the case, then obviously the VDOT study would be done, and obviously that would be done post either approval by this council.
No. Well, we could, it'd be a condition that such a study is.
What I mean though is, Mr. Stipes, let me interrupt, is it's after we approve of it. And so if it's a condition that they would have to abide by any recommendations from the study, or that would dictate from the study, it takes our hands off of it, doesn't it? Unless we were to actually go beyond what VDOT would require, given that we are very familiar with the necessities that are that particular piece of property and that access point.
I think the way the recommendation was written, the street committee and the town staff would still have say-so.
That was my only concern with that.
Generally, VDOT approves subdivisions that are approved by council, but we cannot get final approval until VDOT puts their stamp of approval.
Right, I understand.
So
there's been numbers offered, but I'd characterize them as educated conjecture at this point. They're not bad, but they're significant numbers, over 2,000 trips a day.
Yeah.
And we just need to make sure that the proper analysis is done and that it's reviewed and the appropriate improvements are part of the site plan.
All right.
I'm not sure. One more thing. I'm not sure that the horse is dead. He's possibly in a coma at this stage. But the one thing that bothers me, and Sam Barrow brought it up, is this: that we're proposing a carte blanche, just Chapter 30 zoning in all B3 general districts with one fell swoop tonight, and I'm not sure I like that. Now, is there, and I think the question was posed, is there a way that this can be limited to? Is that spot zoning that word that we all hate to hear, or is there a way that we can improve this for this particular section and review each B3 request on their own merit rather than carte blanche that you can have 30 units per acre or whatever?
Well, we're not talking about carte blanche 30 units per acre. We're saying they all have to come through the process of the CUP, whatever the number is. It has to be approved through the use of CUP. So you're not changing to say in a B3 you can automatically have 30 units per acre. You're saying that whatever is proposed has to be go through the CUP process.
Is that the understanding that we have on that? Well, again, I'm just not willing to give away B3 to any Tom, Dick, and Harry that wants to come in with an apartment complex or set of townhouses.
So we're not planning on taking action on this tonight anyway.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, if there's no one else to speak to this request, I'm going to close the conditional use permit request by Bowser and Associates and declare the Christiansburg Town Council meeting to order. You have a copy of the minutes of the last meeting. I'm sure you've had an opportunity to read. We'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
So moved.
Second. Motion and a second. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And we've had two young ladies waiting very patiently here this evening to speak to us. We have Sue Ferrara, and we also have Nancy Miller from the museum, who are going to talk to us about our local government challenge grant. Ladies?
We're not young anymore.
I'm sure you are.
Thank you. Thank you for letting us come and speak to you tonight. You all have always been such a supporter of the museum, and we really appreciate that. And that support goes a long ways for us. We have filed with the with Mr. Helms the application for the local government challenge grant, and you have approved that in the past, and we would ask and hope that you would approve it again for this year. Another thing that I would like to say is we've also filed a request with the budget, and this year we have made a little supplemental to that to the tune of $5,000. We had an inspection of the museum last year, and there were a number of issues that came up that were deficits in the building, and the one that was a priority was our roof. The building is 150 years old, and the roof is beginning to show its age. We are looking into having it replaced. We have two of the board members that are working diligently to find the best route for that. We're campaigning for funds from our members and the citizens of Christiansburg and the county, and for any additional grants we can find to help finance this roof. So when you look at your budgets and you see that supplemental request of $5,000, just remember, please, that it is to help preserve this 150-year-old lady that's standing on the hill. And we have been blessed with many citizens giving us artifacts to house and to keep for future generations, and for art displays. And so the maintenance of the building and the upkeep of it is of the most importance to us. And we appreciate you hearing us and considering this, and I'll let Sue speak right now.
Thank you. Just for a minute. I just want to tell you how pleased I am to still be at the museum after 3 years and come before you and thank you for your support. I thank those of you who are members of the museum, as that's a main source of our income. And for those of you who are members, you receive a newsletter, and it tells you what's going on. And if you're looking at it, you'll see, I think, that we've increased our focus on arts, which is very much in keeping with the community of Montgomery County. And you'll see what our exhibits are. Currently, we've got a very fine exhibit on the Civil War, and it will end in June. And if you haven't seen it, you should come and see what's there. The next exhibit will be on the new courthouse, and we're working with the court system, so I think that's going to be very much fun to do. The art exhibits are of high quality and draw a lot of viewers, and we're pleased about that. Infrastructure has increased in our museum. We have increased visitors. We have increased our membership, and we're working with a dynamic group of young professionals who have formed a board for the purpose of promoting the museum by doing events that raise money and ensuring the longevity of the museum. We're real excited about this group. A lot of things are going on, and it's not dead just because it's old. So we hope that it will continue to thrive and that you'll come and see us and be part of the museum. But thank you again, and thank you for considering our request.
Okay, brief us, please, on, is this as a matching grant?
Yes.
We do the paperwork, yes, and you do the matching, is that right?
I did the paperwork, and you do the matching.
It's from the Virginia Commission for the Arts.
No, with the funds that town gives are matched by the state.
Bob Hope usually does this.
Well, you know it takes two of us to replace him.
That's what I told you before, and I'll pass that on.
Yeah, Bob.
Thank you very much for coming, ladies, and I assume, is that a slate roof on the museum?
No, it's tin.
It's just a regular, okay. But it needs work.
After 150 years, it needs a little work.
All right, thank you, ladies. We appreciate that very much.
Thank you.
We have also with us an old friend, Tim Carden of the Drug Enforcement Administration. Knew Tim a long, long time ago when he was a whole lot skinnier and much smaller. He's a pretty fair baseball player, too.
My name is Tim Carden. I'm the agent in charge of DEA out of Roanoke. Just as a side note, I'm a former resident of Christiansburg. I grew up in Cambria. I live elsewhere now, but I do work in Roanoke. As the agent in charge of DEA in Roanoke, I supervise and direct enforcement operations for DEA in 34 counties in the state of Virginia. Roughly Rock Ridge, go down south to Pennsylvania, and over to the Tennessee border. Again, I've got about 30 years of law enforcement experience, 25 with DEA, and I was asked to come today to talk to you all about hemp. I'm not here to debate the issue of hemp. I'm not here to try to sway a decision one way or another. I'm not really sure about the resolution. If one of y'all could explain to me the resolution that y'all have before you, I could give you a little bit of insight into that. Again, I'm not going to, I will literally just speak to you today about the legalization issues and DEA's viewpoint there.
Basically, Mr. Carter, from what I understand, the Industrial Hemp Farming Act, it's a resolution to urge the adoption of that act itself, and it's to, I guess, attach ourselves, town of Christiansburg, along with the county board of supervisors, town of Charlottesville, town of Blacksburg, are a couple of the counties that have approved this. After the last meeting in January, I asked Mr. Carden to come here tonight to talk because Mr. Plias gave a good presentation on the pro side of this. And frankly, I felt like that we need to also hear from a legal aspect, from a drug enforcement aspect. And that's why I asked Mr. Carden to come down today to speak about that. But it's basically asking for a resolution from the town of Christiansburg to add our support to the acceptance of the Industrial Hemp Farming Act. And this is an urge to the 112th Congress to do that.
Okay. My response to the hemp issue is very simple. Hemp is marijuana. Hemp is cannabis sativa. Cannabis sativa contains THC, which is the psychoactive drug in marijuana. Marijuana is, in the federal system and in the state system in Virginia, is illegal. In the federal system, it's a violation of the Controlled Substance Act. The Controlled Substance Act within federal government is another fancy term for the drug laws, federal drug laws. Again, it contains THC. You can call hemp whatever, you can call it whatever you want to call it. In the viewpoint of DEA, it's marijuana. It's illegal with the growing of marijuana, with the growing, if you want to, again, call it hemp, it's against federal law. There are states west of here which have adopted state laws which are in contrast with federal law. Those issues are being worked out daily within DEA and within the Justice Department. If, in fact, quite simply, if in fact hemp was grown in Montgomery County under the present state and federal law, it would be illegal. It would be investigated as a crime. Those involved in the growing of marijuana would be investigated and prosecuted. It's a very simple, as far as DEA is concerned, marijuana is very, it's a very simple process, a very simple issue. It's against the control, it's a violation of Controlled Substance Act. Therefore, it's investigated and those involved are prosecuted. And I'll be glad to answer any questions. And unlike most people with the federal government, if I don't know the answer, I won't make one up. I will promise you that, but I will get you an answer.
I think you probably can handle this pretty well. I don't really know anything about this, but I have heard that hemp is a very low grade of marijuana, and it would take a large amount of it to, you know, put a buzz on someone or something like that. Is that correct, or can you help me on that?
Well, again, I'm not a botanist. I'm not a physician. I can only tell you that a THC is just like a drug of marijuana and hemp. And it's against the law, again, and not to belittle or to get away from that subject. I'm simply here to tell you that it's against federal law, it's against state law, presently against state law in the state of Virginia. I would urge you, as far as DEA is concerned, to take this very seriously, because it is a violation of the law in this. You have to take that into effect.
I think one of the things that we're doing on this resolution, we're certainly not proposing to go out and legalize growing industrial hemp in Montgomery County. I think this resolution is one step needed to get it to the state, to let the state decide whether it should become a legal substance to grow the industrial hemp in the state of Virginia. And if the industrial hemp, marijuana, if it is so illegal, why are we using it in about 50% of all the products that we have coming into the country right now? Why can't we stop it on the borders and say, you're not using any of it?
Well, I'd have to disagree with the 50%. I think that might be the pro-hemp side there.
Well, Jim had a pretty good looking shirt on 2 weeks ago that I bought one of. It was all hemp. So,
there you go. Well, I can only tell you that hemp is not grown in the U.S.
We know that.
For a reason.
Right.
There are a lot of products grown all through the world which would never be grown in the U.S. Poppies for heroin, other issues just like that. And I think it's, again, for DEA and for on the federal level, the issue simply is it's an illegal crop. If the state of Virginia, just so you know, if the state of Virginia passed a law legalizing hemp production, the only agency, the only part of the federal government who could grant permission to grow industrial hemp is DEA. You'd have to apply with DEA. To date, no one in the United States has been granted a license or permission to grow hemp in the U.S. And there's a reason for that. There are issues which come out. Again, the THC issue. If it doesn't have THC, most likely it's not hemp. If it doesn't have, it's not marijuana. It's a very simple. As far as DEA is concerned, not to argue the point or to, go pro-hemp or anti, I'm just telling you right up front, it's against the law, federal law and state law. And I'll be honest with you, I would be very surprised in the state of Virginia, in the political realm that we have right now, if that would ever pass.
Tim, would you agree or disagree that the chemical properties of hemp and marijuana are different?
No, I would tell you they're exactly the same. There are different genus species, I'll use that word, different species of cannabis sativa, but all species of cannabis, true hemp, is an Asian hemp, and it contains THC. It's just the way the plant grows and matures. It's still marijuana.
In your job as a DEA rep, are you prosecuting people who are growing hemp?
No one, to our knowledge, in the state of Virginia is growing hemp. Last year in the state of Virginia, we eradicated 27,000 marijuana plants. We arrested 249 people for that within just that
last
year.
But it was identified as marijuana rather than hemp, is that?
There is no distinction in the law. If you pull a hemp plant and send it to the DEA lab in Maryland, it's going to come back as marijuana.
The actual look of the plant, of the industrial hemp plant, or whatever you want to call it, whatever term, and the plant that we all characterize as marijuana, which being one and the same, are there any differences in the appearance?
I have seen over 30 years, I have seen marijuana plants that look like Christmas trees. I've seen marijuana plants that look like palm trees. They're both marijuana. The individuals involved in growing those and producing those were prosecuted for growing marijuana.
Is there anything that you know of through the chemical processes? And I know you already mentioned you're not a botanist, you're not a chemist, about if it's a this 0.3%, which is, seems to be the magic number that we heard and was talked to us about this last time. That 0.3%, the concern I have, frankly, is that your best chemists, in my opinion, don't work for the government. And they're the ones that you all prosecute, frankly. And my point being, is there means by which this particular industrial hemp that contains THC can be purified to a form in which it can produce a high, in other words?
Well, again, I'm not a physician.
Right.
Every chemical affects every person differently. I've seen people that have grown 30% THC marijuana, and I've seen people who have grown 0.5% marijuana. Neither one of them had a problem with selling their product, and no one was complaining at the time. So I think it's just up to the individual person.
Tim, in a statement that we were given, the Virginia General Assembly has urged the federal government to revise the necessary regulations so as to permit the controlled experimental cultivation of industrial hemp in Virginia. And the National Farmers Union has urged the President, the Attorney General, and Congress to direct the USDEA to differentiate between industrial hemp and marijuana and adopt a policy to allow American farmers to grow industrial hemp under state law. It appears that there is a difference between hemp and marijuana. I don't know.
I would ask you where you got that from. I would be very surprised if it was from either a neutral party or from the federal government side. I would say it's probably coming from the pro-hemp.
This came from a resolution.
Again, but I would bet that the resolution would come from the only people who are bringing this up are pro-hemp. The only thing I'm bringing up, again, is the legal aspect of hemp in Virginia and in the country. There are numerous states right now who are requesting permission to do this. DEA is not at this time going to provide permission to anyone to grow hemp. And again, the word hemp is, as far as DEA is concerned, is they want to grow marijuana. There are people in the United States who legally grow marijuana. The University of Mississippi grows marijuana right now for medical studies. They are one of the few that have been granted permission to do so.
Okay. Well, we've heard a very persuasive argument in favor of construction use of industrial hemp, and that it is so much different from what we know as weed or marijuana that smoking a rope has a different concept than smoking a marijuana cigarette.
I agree, and I'm sure the people who presented that were again, pro-hemp. Hemp is not not to get into botany, it's not the wonder plant that the pro-hemp once you think it is. People have said that it doesn't take any fertilizer, it's clean, it's an annual crop, it's like anything. We have gone to hemp, other agencies, other states have found hemp grows. There's fertilizer everywhere. There's issues with erosion. It's not the wonder drug that the pro-hemp people want you to think it is.
All right, well, Tim, thank you so much for coming this evening. I guess we're a little bit at a crossroads because other localities, such as Montgomery County Board of Supervisors, Blacksburg Town Council, has endorsed a resolution favoring industrial hemp.
I can't address that other than they didn't ask me to come talk to them.
Let me ask one more question. Good answer.
What is your opinion on this? A lot of the people, I guess the pro-hemp people, feel like maybe this is an outdated law. This is a law that was put in years ago, and it's outdated. How do you answer that?
I would tell people who want hemp to be changed is to go, just like they're doing now, with a political process. The marijuana laws will not be changed at a state level because of the supremacy clause of the Constitution. A state cannot invoke the law, which is in violation of federal law. It's part of our Constitution. It's one of the first things that our forefathers came up with. If you really want to change the law, go to your congressman, go to your senator. Those are the ones who pass federal law, enact and pass federal law. It's not one to change at a state level. It's just going to be more, as we have today, it's just going to be more controversial until it's done. And it won't be done while I'm...
Saying you can't slice the cake between marijuana and hemp?
No, it's as far as DEA is concerned, as far as I'm concerned, it's an illegal substance. And if I would find a grow of hemp at the moment, it would be eradicated just as I found a grow of marijuana in the National Forest in Virginia. It would be eradicated.
Okay, any questions, Mr. Carden?
No.
Thank you, Tim, for coming.
Thank you very much.
It's always good to see you.
Thank you, sir.
At this point in the program, we'll hear from anyone who would like to address council on any matter. Is there anyone who would like to speak? I figured you would, Mr. Palitas. This will be a presentation, not a debate.
It will be just a couple of minutes. Mr. Garden, I want to thank you for your comments. I'm the person that is trying to get a law change. I'm not trying to break a law. I'm not trying to override a law. I'm trying, not in Virginia by itself, but through the federal government, to change a regulation that will allow industrial hemp. Okay? So, and everything you said was very factual, and I cannot argue with it except for one minor point that you didn't stress enough, but you did state it. Hemp is an illegal substance to be grown without a permit. Okay? You can grow it if you can get the permit. The other minor error, Hawaii, I believe in 1993 or 1999, did get a permit to grow it, but was not renewed. Okay. As the council knows, and I had tried to contact your office some time back, and Mr. Cantrell gets a copy of my emails when I send them out. I'm interested in this for jobs. And I think, or I feel, that the changing of a regulation can create many jobs in Southwest Virginia that are now overseas, jobs that we lost due to cotton industry, due to textile, building materials, and things of that nature. So, and I know it's not the answer end all to all products, but there's enough uses for it that I feel it could make an impact on our local economy. And this is why I'm asking for this to be passed. I'm not asking to break any laws. I'm asking to go through the proper process as you set forth, and that's what I've been attempting to do. And I would really like to speak with you one day about it, if I could. Okay. But that's my statement, and okay, I appreciate it.
Could you tell us again the amount of building materials that are being used with hemp manufacture? You had presented that to us before.
Well, what I had said was they are building homes in North Carolina out of hemp. They make a hempcrete, okay? It takes about 1.5 acres of good crop to build one home. They've built 3 of them down there so far. But building materials, I'll give you a quick update on what's happened in the last 2 days. I've spoken with James Hardy Company, and they are going to write a letter in support of trying to change the regulations so they can look at the product for their construction material. Okay. Yesterday, I got my white paper from Virginia Tech. And on Friday, I have a meeting with the Virginia Department of Agriculture. And the purpose of this white paper is to present it to law enforcement, to commerce, and to ag in a hearing of the Public Policy Commission in Richmond. So hopefully in the next few weeks, I'll be able to make my presentation after the we're going to hand them the white paper on Friday. We have a meeting with the Deputy Commissioner of Agriculture, Travis Hill, Friday morning. So these are things that are, you know, I'm not trying to break laws. I'm trying to adjust them on one particular product. And 0.3%, everything I've read, you cannot get high on, no matter how much you smoke. And yes, it is cannabis. We have wolves and we have chihuahuas and they're canines. So cannabis has got several varieties and some of them are higher and some of them can be nurtured into making higher THC values, industrial hemp. I'm not expecting it just to grow anywhere. We have regulations we're gonna follow. We're going to work with the federal government. This is not just a, let's go out and grow it. You know, it's a process of, and as I've told you folks, of getting regulations so that we can do it and keep as much pressure off the DEA while we're doing it by GPSing, certifying fields and things of this nature. So that's my point. Mr. And Glass, I thank you again for the opportunity to speak.
I have a question, just one question. Yeah. Getting back to the chemistry of here, and I know you're not a chemist, and you can't answer the question, I'm fine with that. But can you give us, is there any assurance to be given that by smoking the industrial hemp, that would be called, what you consider to be industrial hemp, with the THC level of 0.3% or less, which would reduce the headache instead of the high, so to speak, would that be accurate so far?
Well, I say headache because you're going to be drawing in a whole lot of air and nothing else.
Okay.
You know.
My point to that, though, is can that not be that THC be extracted from that particular plant?
I've had that question one time before from our Commonwealth attorney.
Yes.
Okay. And I'm trying to get a definitive answer. Okay. Everything I have read says no. Now, and I'll give you a hypothetical, okay? If you took a bunch of hemp, industrial hemp at 0.3%, maybe you could condense it like you do a can of orange juice and you add water, you know, to make it not so sweet, but maybe you can condense it. But I got a feeling that it would take so much it wouldn't be profitable to do that. And I don't know that that can be done or not, but do you understand what I'm saying? You bought a can of frozen orange juice, and you got to add water to make it drinkable. Well, maybe you can take that hemp and compress it into that situation. And instead of adding water, you know, correct me, I don't know.
But in the meantime, Jim, it is illegal.
It is, no, it's not. It's not. It is illegal to grow without a permit. The permits are sole product of the DEA, okay? The Controlled Substance Act says you cannot grow it without a permit. And we're, you know, trying to get a permit, but we're trying to go about it the right way.
Okay, thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
Hey, Mr. Pods, I'm just curious, why now? I mean, I know this has had to have been debated thoroughly in the past 50 years.
I have been working on this for over 2 years, okay? I look at Southwest Virginia and South Central Virginia, and I see 15% unemployment. I see jobs that have gone overseas and construction and clothing. I see products coming in from Canada, nutrients and things of that nature, okay? And I just feel like this is something that could help regenerate our economy. They said Pennsylvania County, that would be a prime growing area. You know, it will work within every spectrum of the economy, from planting to research and development, detection devices maybe, you know, that we could use for the DEA to help remote detect, you know. I mean, just there's multitudes of, and there's 25,000 products that can be made of it, so.
I understand the benefits, and, you know, that's...
And that's the why important. Is the economy has got to have something to help it.
Well, I guess the question, this has this never come up in the past, since they made it illegal to grow hemp? Has this never come
up? Actually, it's come up in 1999 and 2001.
Right.
The Virginia legislature passed joint resolutions supporting the growth of industrial hemp. This was after they re-legalized it in Europe, and there are 30 countries in the world, 30 plus, that grow it. Our closest one, Canada, all over Europe, Russia, China. And, you know, it's a worldwide big industry, and the statement that was made was a little incorrect about 50%. We buy 50% of the hemp product made. It's not 50% of the stuff that comes in.
But at a federal level, which it's going to take the federal government.
The federal government is going to have to change policy. I am working with our congressman.
But why didn't they do it in 99?
I can't tell you that. That's the Controlled Substance Act has been a very strong act, apparently, and it is being paid attention to by a lot of people. I mean, and I believe in it. You know, but not everything is perfect. So.
All right, Ms. Lindstrom, put a conclusion on it.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Ms.
Platt. Well, I was going to reiterate the 50% of the world's production actually comes back here in country. It is illegal to grow. It's not illegal to use and consume, okay? So what we're doing is we're cutting out the potential for farmers in this country. And I'm not saying necessarily here, because I don't agree that we necessarily have the best soil type here in Montgomery County. Other areas of Virginia, oh yeah, they do. But we would have a perfect environment for some of the manufacturing. But the other key issue for me was the fact that in any given situation, you put me in a room with 20 people, and I bet you that I could take 20 things that looked like a joint. I could have three of them that were oregano, send these 20 people out to different rooms, and every one of them come back claiming to be high. Psychologically, it's not the amount that's in there, it's the expectation. So, but there is a significant difference in the amount of cannabis, or the THC in the cannabis, and the way it's produced. But if we're already buying it from other countries, why do we want to continue making other countries rich when we have our people here in this country who don't have enough food to eat and don't have jobs? Thank you.
So you can get high smoking oregano.
If I convince you that it is pot, yeah, I bet you can.
When I was 13, I smoked corn silk, and it did about the same thing.
It's amazing what the mind can do.
All right, that's enough. Enough confession. Anyone else want to address council on any matter? Thank you very much. Next on the agenda is proposed amendment to the meals tax ordinance of Chapter 11, Finance and Taxation of Christiansburg Town Code. What this does is put a little teeth into our meals tax policy.
Mr. Mayor, I would move that we would accept the proposed amendment as stated, Mr. Mayor.
I'll second it. Motion and a second. Discussion? Just for what it's worth, the news we had several weeks ago about someone owing us meals tax, that's been paid.
Taken care of.
That's been taken care of.
We understand, my understanding is that it gives us a little bit more tooth and ability to collect these any delinquent taxes. Is that through levies and garnishments and everything else, or do we just have, do we just get to threaten them a little bit harder?
Go into their bank accounts and
levies on their. Okay, that's fine.
We've always had that ability, but it just kind of ties in that what we couldn't do before was, for example, withhold a business license because somebody hadn't paid something. And this kind of lets us do that. We got caught on a couple of situations where something wasn't done or something wasn't taken care of. There was a permit or license that they wanted, and we didn't have enough teeth in the law to say, sorry, we can't give you that license because.
Okay.
So this kind of does that.
Okay, you have a motion on the floor to approve the amendment to the meals tax ordinance. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. Next is the reappointment of Jennifer Sowers to the Christiansburg Planning Commission. Ms. Sowers' term expired February 2nd, and we need to renew her for another 4 years. And Jennifer is here tonight. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
So moved.
Well, has there been any issue with her attendance rating? I know you're here, Jennifer. I'm kidding.
Oh, okay. We have a motion and a second for the reappointment of Jennifer to the Planning Commission for a 4-year term. Discussion? Before we vote, Jennifer, thank you for your service. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Congratulations. Resolution in support of industrial hemp farming. You have the resolution in front of you, and some of it we have read portions of.
Mr. Mayor, I would move that we do not endorse the resolution as stated.
I'll second it.
A motion not to accept the, or not to adopt the resolution.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor.
Based on comments made by Mr. Carden and others.
For me, it's a couple of things, frankly. I mean, if we're going to discuss it, I mean,
we're in discussion now.
My problem would be that some of what we talked about before, I've not received any comments from any member of the town of Christiansburg in support of this, so it's not as if the town's behind this or the citizenry. By us signing this resolution, we are in fact signing that the town and the citizens that we represent endorse this matter. For 80 years, this has been an illegal act. It's federally regulated. It's federally illegal to do it. A good illustration would be that, you know, you call it industrial hemp. It's industrial marijuana, if you want to call it whatever it is. It's like the War Department and the Defense Department now. You can rename it all you want to make it more palatable to the everyday person. It is marijuana. The chemistry of it, it is not detailed yet. It is not done yet. It's not been tested yet to see if it can be extracted to the point where the THC can be combined. But all I know is what's been presented to us by Mr. Politis last time is that it has grown very densely. And if it's grown very densely, then more of it is available. And finally, I'm not aware of any place in the town of Christiansburg which will be able to support industrial hemp farm. We don't have the room for it. I think it's something, frankly, we would be approving if we did approve it for the purposes of acting at the behest or in conjunction with the town of Blacksburg and Montgomery County. And I'm not in support of that.
Do you want to leave a door open for consideration at another time with additional information like the white paper or?
Well, I believe you mentioned that there's a study out there, which, I mean, there's a lot of open doors to it. And I do believe, and you mentioned 1999, State of Virginia passed a resolution. And, you know, this is a federal decision. And I agree with Cord, where I would challenge anybody to see how this affects our citizens here in Christiansburg. I don't want to take away a job from anybody in Southside or in Central Virginia. And I do think this is a good, you know, thing that Jim's taking. But it's still a state decision, I mean a federal decision, and I think there's just too many open doors on whether this is a good thing or a bad thing.
The other issue there, too, is that when you talk about increasing jobs or adding jobs to the area, I look at it as far as a total market share. You add jobs in the realm of, for instance, industrial hemp or using hemp to produce clothing, you're obviously going to be taking those jobs away from another sector. And in my opinion, it's more of a lateral move. That person who's working here hopefully would now be getting a job in this sector. I don't see where it adds. I think a lot of it is speculation on both sides. But the reality of the situation is it's a federal law. And I simply don't want my name attached to anything urging the modification of the Controlled Substance Act. I think it's inappropriate. I think that our Tommy Witt, the county sheriff, is against this. I think Chief Sisson wrote a good letter and said he has concerns about this. I know the DEA out of Roanoke, who represents this county, or would enforce that in this county, is against this. I know our task force works in conjunction with that DEA. I've had a lot of problems with this. It's something I deal with, but it's nothing to this level, of course. It's nothing against Mr. Pilatus. He did a fantastic presentation. I have concerns. It looked just like it when I saw the picture. It looked from here to there, and I can't differentiate. Could be biased, but I think it's inappropriate.
I think that this resolution is no more different than the petitions we all sign any time that we want to stand election for town council. Doesn't mean by signing it we're going to vote for it. So this is no more than a petition to ask the state of Virginia to pursue it in a further manner. Does not say that we're going to open our doors to him. Doesn't say that we're going to do anything other than request the state of Virginia to add it to some form of legislature to start the process of getting it approved. It's no more than that.
This doesn't ask the state of Virginia, it asks the 112th Congress,
okay.
Which right. Is the federal.
Okay.
And to me, I don't support it either because we're asking them to allow us to do something, and I think that more study needs to be done because if it was made it illegal 80 years ago, there's got to be some reason made illegal. It needs to be more study, taking a look at it and see what they can do. And I have some of the same concerns Mr. Hall does about people being able to cultivate it, modify it, extrapolate it or whatever to make it give you the same performance you would have with marijuana. And we have enough problems with things like this without going another step. Right.
Again, I'm not 100% comfortable in the fact of what could happen to this hemp. All I'm saying is this is no more different than a petition you sign for any other public election. Whether I will probably support this, I'll most likely get beat, but I have to look at it not so much for the principle of what they're asking, but the fact that this is the first step, and the first step that we have to take to get it to move elsewhere.
Well, that's really not true. You're asking the Congress to adopt it and allow the DEA to.
We're asking it to get on the ballot somewhere to go up.
Well, specifically, we're asking for the adoption of the
Industrial Hemp Act. We're asking for the adoption, not to get on the ballot.
Okay.
For the adoption.
I'd like to get my. Have a hard time talking tonight, and you all can thank me later for that. I don't care too much one way or the other. I think Mr. Pilatus made a very compelling case for it. I don't really care too much one way or the other. I will say tonight, Councilman Hall, that your point about what's the dog that Christiansburg has in the fight for this, Is it likely we would grow it here? No. Is it like, what's the purpose of us taking our necks out one way or the other when it really is a, sort of a moot point as far as representing our citizenry? So my hat's off to you for making that point. I don't see the need to support it from that standpoint. So that's off to you for that point.
All right, well, wait.
Let me see. I haven't heard from me yet. I think it seems like the DEA cannot separate marijuana from hemp, that they classify them both as the same thing. And I think that would be the first step that would have to be made here, to have somebody do that, to separate these two entities. And with it out, I mean, you're just going to open up the doors for other things.
Oh, I forgot to say one important thing. I'm very disappointed after 20 minutes of talk about this tonight, I learned nothing. It's a splitting a fog here four ways with a broad axis, whether it's legal or not legal.
We
heard two speakers, and I learned nothing tonight.
We have a motion on the floor to not adopt a resolution in support of industrial hemp. Ms. Clerk, will you poll council on this matter, please?
Councilman Barber.
No.
Councilman Hall.
Aye.
Councilman Huppert.
Aye.
Councilman Showalter.
Aye.
Councilman Stipes.
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier.
Aye.
I think I counted 5-1. Is that right, Ms. Clerk? So the motion to not adopt the resolution is passed. I hope, though, that at some point in the future we can be receptive to information that may be coming back to us that would support it. In principle, it sounds like it may be worthy. You have spoken, and I accept what you have said. Annual taxi cab license renewal for the Christiansburg Cab Service. Mr. Helms?
Mr. Mayor, do we forget number 3?
They adjusted the agenda.
Okay. Christiansburg Cab Service has requested to renew their taxi cab business license. And that takes town council action. They have requested 6 drivers: Robert Jerry Vaughn, Irene Trout Vaughn, Rita Bradbury, Crystal S. Davidson, Dan Truman East, and James Robert Trout. And police department, police chief has recommended approval for all of those drivers. And so I recommend approval for them also.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve the annual taxi cab license renewal. Discussion.
And the drivers.
And the drivers. Those drivers listed. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carries. Are we ready to change out? All right, let's take this next one. Discussion regarding the unsolicited PPEA proposal for a pavement maintenance program.
We received a PPEA proposal from Lanford Brothers Company. The proposal is to help the town staff evaluate the information that we get from Virginia Tech Transportation Institute, plan our pavement maintenance work, provide construction services, and conduct training for our street maintenance crews. This is going along with what Mr. Nelson briefed on last week, our pavement maintenance program. I'm asking council to accept the proposal for consideration and to advertise for competing proposals. So you're not accepting it as a, you're agreeing to it, you're just going to let us evaluate it and put out for, essentially put it out for bid for
right.
Other
locations. We need to take action on that.
Yes, sir.
We need
also
a motion.
Move. Second.
Motion to put this out for bids. Discussion.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Let's change the tape, and then we're going to have a request for a closed session. Okay, we have a request for a closed meeting under Virginia Code Section 2.23711A-1 for discussion, consideration, or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, performance, demotion, salary, discipline, or resignation of specific public officers, appointees, or employees of a public body. Closed meeting is being held to discuss the Planning Commission applicant interviews held on January the 24th, 2012.
So moved.
Second. Motion to go into executive session. Ms. Clerk, will you poll council?
Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye. Okay, we're going to take a short break and be back here in just about 5 minutes, please.
I move to certify that the Town Council of Christiansburg meeting in closed session. Let me start this over. I move to certify that the Town Council of the Town of Christiansburg meeting in closed session meeting, in the best of each member's knowledge, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempt from open meeting requirements by Virginia law, and only such matters are as identified in the resolution to enter into closed session.
Second. Second.
Second.
Ms. Clerk, will you poll council?
Yes, sir. Councilman Barber?
Aye.
Councilman Hall?
Aye.
Councilman Hubbard?
Aye.
Councilman Showalter?
Aye.
Councilman Stipes?
Aye.
Councilman Van Hoosier?
Aye.
That's a 6-0. We're back in regular session. And the action that we discussed during closed session was the number of Planning Commission members that we will appoint. And I believe that the motion was for 3.
Subject to background check.
Subject to background checks. Motion and a second.
Second.
I'll first. I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
We've got the names of the 3 that you're...
Yes. Well, we won't appoint them until the next time. But one will be appointed to a 2-year term, and 2 will be appointed to a 4-year term. And all in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. We'll be making those appointments at our next meeting. Mr. Town Manager.
Yes, sir. Have the bills. Get a copy of them. I'll try to answer any questions. If I can't, maybe Ms. Tweedy can.
I move to pay the bills.
Second.
Motion and a second to pay the bills. Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Mr. Helms, Ms. Tweedy, pay the bills.
Okay, I need to set one public hearing, which would be on the council's intention to adopt an ordinance amending Chapter 30 zoning of Christiansburg Town Code in regards to residential density allowances in residential, mixed-use, and business districts. The Town Council could have this on the 6th of March. This is a request by the Planning Commission as part of this, the review of the conditional, our public hearings at night. They also think that it would be wise to change the residential number of units in a residential unit, or number of units, residential units in mixed-use and business districts. To increase them so that if we had a mixed use, we wouldn't have to be going through this again.
Is that number presently 10, Randy?
Yes, it is. They specifically mentioned MU2 as wanting to possibly expand that to 16 units per acre. But I have a file to it so that they can look at all the districts if they like.
I'm sorry, but that would answer the question because of it.
And that requires a joint public hearing or just a public hearing?
And a joint public, well, they'll have their public hearing and council will have your public hearing.
Randy, did you say, what was the number?
March 6th.
March 6th.
16?
6.
No.
Do 16 units or 15 units?
16.
And you two is what they specifically.
Do I hear a motion to put that on the adoption for the 6th?
Second.
Did I hear a second?
Yes.
Motion and a second to put it on for March 6th. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Anything else?
At some point, we need to have a public hearing on the joinder study. Not like any time soon, I don't, not want to set the date, but would y'all prefer to have an independent public hearing for just town council? Or you want to have a joint one with Blacksburg Town Council?
Well, we had one with Blacksburg Town Council the other day. I thought that was very productive.
It wasn't a public hearing, though.
Yeah.
So.
Public meeting is not a public.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I got you.
So I just want to know which way to pursue trying to set it up when time comes. And we don't have to decide tonight, you think about it.
That's what I was going to say.
We're looking at about December of 13.
December of 13.
2001?
My personal opinion is that it's our public hearing and that we're going to have to make decisions. So I'd say let's have our own public hearing and let them have their own public hearing.
Now, how we left that was there was a lot of questions. A lot of, I think what both groups wanted, you know, certain things explained and some additional items put into any type of agreement. Have you heard about any timeline that they're going to get back to us on that or?
They're working on, they've broken up into sort of subcommittees to do studies on each one of those questions. Hope to have a meeting the 19th? 29th.
I'm sorry, Wayne.
29th to try to wrap things up as much as possible. I doubt it'll be finished by the 29th, but that's what they're shooting for.
I don't particularly think we need to get involved in any kind of public hearing on this thing until they get answers to our specific questions. So I think the question was, when and if we have it, we will have it as our public hearing.
That's what I want to know.
That's what I would recommend.
And made an offer to an individual for Parks and Recreation Director. They accepted, we're waiting on background check. As soon as we get that, we'll make an announcement with the name.
Excellent. All right, what else you got, Mr. Town Manager?
Received about 100 applications for the assistance job and starting phone interviews. Narrowed down to seven to start off with. Hopefully one of those seven will be the next assistant town manager.
Are you encouraged?
Yeah.
Are you really positive? Good applications?
Had very good application. Had some, a town manager or two, some assistant town managers, some deputy town managers, two attorneys, PhDs.
I hope you learned your lesson on these damn attorneys.
Only the ones that don't like their bosses.
And those that don't like the boss. So there you go.
That's all I have, sir.
All right. Let me make a suggestion here. Since we had several items on the agenda tonight that goes back to the planning commission, I would like to have the minutes of the planning commission, their last meeting folded into our minutes. Would that be permissible, council?
Well, you'd include them as part of your agenda packet.
Yeah, it's part of the agenda packet.
Yeah, it's in there now.
And we keep them together since they all.
Speaking of minutes, Mayor, don't forget you've got that January 24th special meeting minutes that you've got in your packet that you haven't approved yet.
I move we approve.
I second. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. I appreciate being corrected.
Just a reminder.
All right, we have a motion to approve the January 24th meeting. That was a short interview meeting. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Jim, appreciate it. When's Kai coming back?
She sits next to the clerk, too, and she said the same thing. The clerk mentioned it.
Not saying enough.
All right, if there's nothing else to come before council, we are adjourned.